Hey, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. You know, like I want to begin having a conversation about alchemy. And I would say it's a kind of a mysterious subject, and people have kind of some ideas, but it's not something that can be explained very quickly and very easily. A lot of times you have to do it through having a series of experiences, you know, because it's outside your normal way of thinking, you could say. So regardless if you're interested in or not, it's tied to meditation practice, it's tied to healing, it's tied to your cognitive functions and how your mind works, it's tied to your ability to grow and evolve as a soul, grow and evolve in relationships, grow and evolve in business settings. And so, you know, I'd like to take a look at it, but more from a practical side, a practical application. And let's look at it from the point of view when we meditate, right? We go through and, you know, with a starter, we spend a lot of time bringing in the white light. And the being that gave the teachings to Astara through early Qing was Kutumi, right? And Kutumi, you could say, is very connected to the white light. And Kutumi is also very connected to alchemy. Kutumi is also very connected to inner transmissions or the transmission of teachings, which is very different than accumulating facts and information and then forming ideas and thoughts. There is, you could almost call them like awakenings or empowerments for you to be able to perceive something, to process something, or have a stream of awareness or stream of consciousness pass through. A lot of this has to do with the ability to go beyond your senses. You know, so with Astara is very much a mystical practice. If you take the teachings from the books and start applying them. And then you look at the kinds of meditations that we're looking at, that it's a very much a mystical practice. It also involves the cultivation of intuition and the cultivation of clairvoyance. And in a way, clairvoyance is nice, but it's not the point. There's something that as you develop this process, that you're starting to develop abilities that go beyond the sensory realm or the realm of normal everyday life. The issue is that normal everyday life is so consuming to our emotions and our physiology that it is a source of our suffering, it is a source of disease, and it is a very big source of our fears. So when you hear in Buddhism, they're doing practices for liberation. You could say liberation is liberation from being so consumed by the senses. And even when you look at enlightenment, it's not so much about what comes in or that you go up to the light, or it's really more about something that you let go of. Or you could say a series of little things that you go let go of. And there's this tendency to kind of cling on to things that have to do with the form. And so as you go through and you do meditation, you do work with angels, you do devotional practices to deities, you know, to Christ or Buddha or, you know, whoever is of your tradition, part of what you're doing is you're unwinding some of this, right? And so right now, we're going to take this idea that seems very, very abstract, and we're going to start doing some exploration of these processes, right? It's not so much about the form. It's just like when you meditate, you kind of expand, right? But what does that mean, right? Consciousness or awareness expands into something different than your normal everyday life, right? Then when you start taking a deeper look, there's different kinds of meditation. There's the sustained awareness that we call Lama Yoga or Dhyana or Zen. That is, like you could say, a certain realm, right? Then there is the state of oneness, right? When we go through and we do meditation on the blue pearl, when we do meditation on the inner eye, when we hear the inner sound, there is a greater degree of oneness, right? And this is a little bit of a different realm or place than when you have sustained awareness. Then you have the Kundalini practice where you're circulating energy through the body. You're developing focus. You're developing the ability to move energy through the body, right? And in a way, with that, you're also beginning to have the ability to manipulate the form. Now, even that's a little elusive. Right? Manipulating the form can be your thought processes, your ways of thinking, your formation of opinions, for example. But also in the physical body, it could be harnessing the law of cycles and change to create shifts and change in physical forms, right? So very good for healing process, very good for bringing something in. And then putting something in motion so that when you turn your attention away, it continues. This is literally the meaning of creative destruction or divine power, is the ability to bring something in and take action, put something in motion so that when your attention turns away, it continues. So this action is of light. When it's of darkness, it is a reaction. And it just starts a loop that you never really are able to break out of until some light comes in, right? So this idea of a Kundalini practice, if you think about it, it is tied to the coiled serpent down around the base of the tailbone. In certain traditions, they'll call it the sacred fire, but this has to do with something lower. And you could say there is a realm of existence that is below your feet, right? So if you think about it, you have your expansion of consciousness and awareness, and you're having experiences of brilliant white light or bliss, peace, stillness, and you have this beautiful, beautiful meditation experience. And then what happens? You have to come back into your body. And when you come back into your body, the first thing you usually do, or you're prompted to do, is wiggle your fingers and wiggle your toes, right? So, on one level, you could say, you have this expanded state. And in this state of expansion, at some time, you have to come back into the body and ground that energy, right? You have to be grounded so that you can function in the day. That is true, but that is not the goal when you do that. The goal is to experience light and then come back into your body, and through the act of grounding, you continue to pass light and consciousness into that realm that is below your feet, right? Then that has an impact on how your energy centers function, your chakras function, and more importantly, how your mind functions. So, with this, you could see this in the story of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, right? The dwarfs are referred to as dwarfs because they are from that realm below your feet. You know, in these beautiful realms below your feet, they say there's beautiful jewels, there's gold and jewels and these things like this. And if you think about what they talk about with dwarves, is they are very good at mining and going into the earth and pulling out the precious metals and the jewels and things. This is symbolic in nature, but what you could also say is the dwarves represent an underdeveloped chakra, so to speak. Like in each of the dwarves directly corresponds to one of the seven chakras. And then Snow White, notice it's not snow blue or snow red, it's snow white, you know, going back to the white light, it's snow white. And Snow White being feminine represents the sacred fire down at the basic chakra that is laying dormant or asleep. The energy of the higher soul comes in and kisses the princess and wakes her up, right? Wakes her up. And once this is awoken, if you pay attention to the story in the Walt Disney version, if you've ever watched the cartoon, all of a sudden the dwarves get brighter and they become their better selves, like they become happier, right? But if you pay attention to what happens when Snow White wakes up, is she cleans the house and feeds the dwarves. And this is a very, very deep esoteric principle. She feeds the dwarves and cleans the house. Your spiritual development is not about what comes in or down, it's what goes back up. It's what from that lower realm before below your feet gets mixed with light and then heads back up. Because as the light mixes, what happens is the light and the form mix, and then it starts going up through your centers and eventually through the top of your head, and then eventually up out of the top of your head, and you could say 12 inches above your head, and then sometimes even higher. Now in the Buddhist tradition, you could say the white light or the descent of white light is tied to a particular being or aspect that you could say is associated with the birds or the winged creatures, right? And so sometimes they look at it as an eagle, sometimes they refer to it as Garuda, which is the winged bird that Vishnu rides, which is the aspect of God that's love, right? And so if you think about what we've talked about in the past, for there to be love, there first has to be light. And so this great, great avatar of light or love has to ride this being of light, right? And so in this, there is teachings. And you could say for this aspect of bringing in light, for it to come in more, it's not that you go up and you go, oh, I'm saying my prayers, I'm saying my mantras, I want to bring this light in. To bring the light in, you don't go up, you go down. You go down to the realm below your feet, you mix whatever light you have, and then you take it back up. So our first instinct is to turn up, right? But really it's to go down and then up. Right. So this is the whole basis. This is the whole philosophy of really what healing is. It is literally the deeper meaning to the aspect of the caduceus, right? Because the caduceus is the staff that, you know, some great being can go down into the lower realm and bring people out of their suffering and up into the heavens, right? So this idea of what they would call in the Essene tradition is feeding the gods, right? Feeding the gods. And you're basically kind of, in a way you could say you're purifying or sacrificing your animal nature or your nature that's tied to just the earthly life or the sensory life, and you're offering it up to something that's of the light or beyond the senses, so to speak. And so without having this experience, it's really hard to talk about alchemy. Like you really have to, you don't have to intellectually understand it, but we want to have the experience so that we have the building material to manipulate matter, which is, people take it very literal when they talk about alchemy, but it's really about bringing light into that realm below your feet, and then different things that you do with it with the body, right? Body, motions, mind. So we go through, we bring light in, and we come, we do our meditation, we come down, we put our awareness on our feet after we're done with meditation to ground. And what's happening is the light that we experienced in the meditation is now starting to emanate through the bottoms of our feet into this lower realm. And there's a little bit of mixing that happens that then kind of moves a little bit of that sacred fire, or that kundalini energy up, right? And so once this happens, you start to have a greater ability to perceive the light. You have the greater ability to perceive these different places or these different realms, right? And so with this, we're gonna begin a little bit of an exploration of these ideas, like these practices. And it's not that we haven't been, we're going to be a little bit more direct about it, right? And so, like, sometimes if you go through and you look at Buddhist paintings and things, there's a thing called inner dharma and outer dharma, right? And dharma just means teachings. There's things that we realize, and then there's things in paintings and statues and stained glass windows in the Christian tradition. You know, there's all kinds of ways to give the teachings in an outer way, right? And so if you look at it from the point of view of Buddhism, right? If you look at the idea of white Tara, right? White Tara is completely white, and there's an eye on her forehead, and then there are eyes in the palms of her hand and eyes in the soles of her feet. And you could say that the eye on the forehead is tied to her inner eye, right? Her inner eye. And when the inner eye, or what we would call the blue pearl, or the center in the middle of the pineal gland, or the mental permanent seed, is somewhat activated, you kind of have a little bit of bliss, some light comes in, and then we let it go. And then it gets activated again, and then we let it go. But at some point, you're able to stay there for periods that are a little bit longer. And as you are able to stay there longer, you begin to see things while you're in that seat of the blue pearl. You start to see out the forehead, which is the awareness of your surroundings, right? The awareness of subtle things, the awareness of the soul, awareness of whatever is in your environment, awareness of the body, awareness of the breath. Then as you take this awareness deeper and deeper, you start to look at situations in your life through this vision of the inner eye, and you start to look at the chakras through the inner eye, like you're looking at your energy center with your awareness, or you could say still seated in that blue pearl, right? And then the deeper practice is to be able to keep your awareness on the blue pearl as you keep your awareness on the palms of your hands, right? And then eventually you do it with your feet, the soles of your feet. I find it a little bit interesting too, Christ being nailed to the cross, what do they nail? The hands and the feet. And then there's the crown of thorns. Very interesting. So what we're going to do is we're going to be prepping for this thing where you're basically kind of, in a way, cultivating a thing that they call in Hinduism is samayama, right? It is the development of focus, it's the development of awareness, and it's the development of oneness, each individually, and then at some point there is an emergence between focus, awareness, and oneness, where they all become fused and they become the triple flame that is in the heart. Another way of saying this triple flame that's in the heart is the heart of intelligence. right? It's when the intellect and how you feel are fused and become this one interactive piece, right? For most people walking around, the mind and the emotions function separately. You know, there is a duality between them. You know, they're not connected. You know, they interact with each other, but they're not intertwined, right? And so we're going to use the mantra for White Tara, and we're going to start prepping the body to have some deeper meditation, some stronger meditations. And this mantra for Tara, its meaning basically is, or its function is to help to eliminate the sources of our suffering, right, the causes of our suffering. It's to help alleviate the sources of our fears, and it's to help alleviate the sources of our disease in the body, you could say. And so this could be used for healing. This could be used for spiritual practice. It's very soothing. It's very gentle. It's it helps, let's just say, bring in more light. Combined with Om Mani Padme Hum, these become very powerful mantras. And then combined with a couple other mantras that we'll be doing later, it becomes even more powerful. You know, you're developing these different aspects. So we're going to do this in phases, you know, and I know we're only on these little budgeted times of 30 minutes here and then 30 minutes in the next session. I highly encourage you to join us in the next session. You know, right now we'll get the ball rolling. But we're going to roll over to the mystical vibration practice and continue with what we're talking about, what we're doing here. So close your eyes and silently affirm, I am surrounded by the pure white light. Only good shall come to me. Only good shall go from me. Om Mani Padme Hum. Om Mani Padme Hum. I will do the mantra for Tara, and just sit and be still. Keep your eyes closed. Your tongue, gently touch your tongue to the roof of your mouth. And let's just get the ball rolling, okay? Om Tare Tu Tare Tur Soha. 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 I am surrounded by the pure white light. Only good shall come to me. Only good shall go from me. Your awareness is on your heart. Move your awareness to the back heart, the area between your shoulder blades, the back heart. Keep your awareness on the back heart.
Om Tare Tutare Tur Soha. 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 Om Tare Tutare Tur Soha.
Take a long, slow, deep breath. Your awareness is on your back heart. You're taking a long, slow, deep breath. Move your awareness back to the front heart, the center of your chest. Keep your awareness there. Think of a prayer that you'd like to offer up. It can be for some difficulty you're having in your life. It could be just a prayer of gratitude. Prayer for someone else, a prayer for things that you see going on in the world. One of the best ways to move past our sensory mind is to pray for others. Keep your awareness on your heart. Om Tare Tutare Tur Soha. 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 We're going to switch over to the other stream. Please join us. We're going to continue. So sorry, we have this little thing that we have to shift it instead of just having the stream, but let's shift over to the other streaming session and we'll continue.
Can we put the link in the chat? You want to jump over?